Hi, it's Michelle from Lab Muffin Beauty Science here, chemistry PhD, skincare nerd, and sunscreen nerd. Being the sunscreen nerd person, I get a lot of questions about unusual sunscreen products and whether or not their claims work out. Last time I talked about the ColorScience powder sunscreen and the Skinny's pea-sized amount claim. I'll link that in the description. This time I'm back with two more products that lots and lots of people have asked me about. Evie has a range of high-tech foam sunscreens that are meant to last for really long on your skin, so 6 to 8 hour claims, in water with towel rubbing. Dermablend have the Flawless Creator pigment drops that you're meant to be able to mix into sunscreens without compromising the SPF protection. Like I mentioned last time, I try to talk to the company to work out what their reasoning is behind the claim. Why exactly are they making the claim? What evidence they have? And then I try to match that with what we know about sunscreen. I try to keep an open mind about innovations, even if they sound pretty unusual, because as we all know, sunscreen is not that great. A lot of the time there are lots of issues, and that's why a lot of people don't apply enough, or they don't apply it properly, or they might not even wear sunscreen at all. And there are also a lot of innovations that just don't show up in the peer-reviewed literature. So a lot of the time there's just no incentive for a company to conduct the research and get it to a point where it will be accepted in the peer-reviewed literature. Sometimes it's just too new to be there. Sometimes they just want to protect their intellectual property, and sometimes there are complicated legal reasons why we don't have them there. So I think it's really important to talk to the company and try to understand where they're coming from. Again, a disclaimer, these are my opinions. I could be wrong. If you disagree, then let me know in the comments. Please don't sue me, please. If you like nerding out about the science behind skincare products, click the like, the subscribe, and the notification bell so you don't miss any videos. Let's start with Evie. Evie are a Swedish sunscreen brand, and they have a range of these mousse sunscreen products. They're really popular in Sweden and in Europe, and their most impressive claim is that their sunscreen lasts through a lot. So it lasts through 6 to 8 hours on your skin, it lasts through dipping into water, it lasts through sweat, towel rubbing, and so on. Their claims have actually been on my radar for a while because they're really amazing claims, they really solve some issues that we have with sunscreens, and it would be amazing if they were true. And based on the data I've looked at, I think it could actually be true. I bet some of you never thought I would actually say that. So most sunscreen products rely on the sorts of formulation tricks that barrier creams use as well. So in other words, they try to make the sunscreen stay on a layer on the top of your skin, and they try to make that layer as continuous and even and as long lasting as possible. Some of these creams also sink a little bit into the top layers of skin. But the problem with a product that's mostly on the top layer is that it's on the outside. And so it shifts around, it gets rubbed off, and over time that protection decreases. And that's why you're meant to reapply your sunscreen every 2 hours. So to try to deal with these issues, some sunscreens use different technologies to get those sunscreen ingredients a little bit deeper into the skin, into the stratum corneum, the top dead layers. You might have heard of liposomal sunscreens. These have little liposomes in them. They're sort of like little micelles. And so these package the sunscreen ingredients until it goes into your stratum corneum and then it releases them. So you end up with a layer that's in the top layer of your skin. So it doesn't get rubbed off as much. And it's not deep enough that it'll still be near the surface. It'll still be an effective screen. Evie uses a special patent that involves a mix of glycerin, dimethicone, and fatty acids like lauric acid and stearic acid. This patent is actually used for other things as well, so it's used in some treatments for atopic dermatitis or eczema. And one really interesting thing about this patent is that it can actually increase your skin's resistance. It increases the barrier function. So it works as a better barrier, and this is very unusual for a penetration enhancer because a lot of the time penetration enhancers that get things deeper into your skin will actually decrease your barrier function, so it opens it up a bit so that things can get through. This is slightly different. It seems to deliver it and then seal it in. Another bonus, because this isn't a barrier, is that it also doesn't seem to interfere with sweating, and it doesn't make you feel as hot. The biggest bonus with sunscreen, of course, is that because it's a little bit deeper, it doesn't get wiped away or washed away anywhere near as easily. So there's a mechanism for why Evie sunscreens might work better than other sunscreens, but does it actually hold out in practice? Evie is sold in Sweden and the EU, and they tend to have higher requirements for claims compared to other countries. They're also a pretty famous brand in Sweden. They've won lots of awards, so it's not really like they'd slip under the radar of their regulators. So I asked Evie if I could see their tests, and they were nice enough to show me, and they said I could share some of the results here. I don't think they showed me all of their tests because I think there's some intellectual property stuff. They want to keep some stuff private, but yeah, I'm really impressed by the tests I've seen so far, and I get the feeling that they've done a lot more tests on their products than a standard company would. With the tests I saw, they sent their sunscreens to a third-party testing lab, and this lab used modified versions of the official ISO tests for SPF and for water resistance. I talked about the ISO SPF tests in my video on Pareto. Basically, they put the sunscreen at 2 milligrams per square centimeter on the backs of volunteers, and then they expose them to UV and see how much UV it takes for them to get sunburnt. So these are the tests they performed on the longevity claims. Firstly, the claim that it lasts for 8 hours on skin. This was done on two of their sunscreens. They took the sunscreens, put it on the volunteers, and then tested the SPF. And then they waited 8 hours and then tested the SPF again. And with both of these, the SPF actually increased after 8 hours. Now, I'm not sure if the SPF actually increased because the sunscreen interacted with the skin differently, or if it's just experimental error, but I think either way, it's a pretty good indication that the SPF stays at least around the same. They also performed an 8-hour water resistance test on their SPF 50 mousse. Now, the standard water resistance test is only 80 minutes, so this is 480 minutes, which is 6 times normal. They put the sunscreen on the volunteers, they sat in a whirlpool for a total of 8 hours, so the actual protocol is they go in and then they come out, and they go in and they come out, and then in total though, in the whirlpool, they were there for 8 hours, which is a lot. Then after the 8 hours of dipping, probably more like 12, 14 hours in total, they let the sunscreen area air dry and then they tested the SPF again. The SPF went from 53 down to 35.2, which is not a massive drop. It's really impressive for 8 hours. They also did towel abrasion tests on two of their sunscreens. So they applied the sunscreen, they waited 20 minutes, and then they took a towel and applied moderate pressure and stroked over it several times. Then they tested the SPF again, and for both of the sunscreens, the SPF stayed around the same. They also tested sweat resistance, so volunteers had to sit inside a sauna at 37-ish degrees for at least an hour of sweating. So they started the timer when the volunteers started sweating profusely, so there were like drips going over the sunscreen, and then after that, they tested the SPF. And for both of the sunscreens tested, the SPF went down a little bit, about 10%. They also did the standard 80 minutes of water resistance with different types of water. So they did chlorinated water and they did salt water. And in both of these circumstances, the SPF went down about 10%. I am really impressed. They have done quite a lot of in vivo clinical testing on actual humans with their actual sunscreens. This is pretty rare when it comes to sunscreens because these tests are really expensive. I am really impressed. If you look at my old video, you can see some examples where people try to use less expensive tests and just join the dots rather than actually test it in real life on real people. One issue with these supplementary extracurricular tests is that they were only done on 2 or 3 people, unlike the standard SPF test, which is generally done on 10 people. So these are going to be less reliable results than the standard 10 people test, but if you look at the individual results, they're actually quite in close agreement, so I think it's reasonably reliable. I would obviously prefer more subjects and maybe tests from different labs. I think Evie are actually working on getting tests from different labs for their claims, but I also understand that these tests are really expensive and it can be really hard to get volunteers. Like, if you look at the protocols, they are pretty nasty. Like, I would probably not want to get sunburn and then go in and out of a hot tub for 12, 14 hours and then get sunburned again. That just sounds like medieval torture. And this is considered enough by the regulators to substantiate their claims, so there's not really a big incentive to pay so much more for tests that tell you pretty much the same thing. So I think these claims are pretty legit. But I also understand the regulatory perspective, where the regulators in some countries just don't want to let a brand claim that their product lasts for 6 hours, even though we have these results. These tests were done on a small area of skin with perfect application. But in real life, people don't apply enough. They don't apply sunscreen in certain areas. They skip bits like between your eyes, around your eyes, sometimes the top of an ear. Having a second application means you can fix that mistake. And so instead of having a bare patch for 6 hours, you would have a bare patch for 2 hours. I personally use the heavy sunscreen and I trust the 6 hour claim, but I still personally try to reapply every 2 hours because I know that my application a lot of the time isn't that great. But I appreciate the fact that this sunscreen is a lot more resistant to whatever I happen to be doing, and it's like an extra level of backup in case I forget to reapply on time. The other product I'm talking about today is the Dermablend Flawless Creator Drops. Dermablend is a L'Oreal brand and they're famous for their high coverage products, so they can cover up tattoos, they can cover up different types of pigmentation. Flawless Creator Drops are pigmented drops that you can use as a really lightweight foundation, or you can mix them into other products. And supposedly you can mix them into your sunscreen without compromising the protection. It's been mentioned in sponsored content, so I assume it comes from the brand. It was mentioned on their website, I think. It's currently not mentioned on their website, but in their product descriptions on Ulta and on Macy's, it's still there. Usually those product descriptions are supplied by the brand. It's also on their Instagram highlights reel. It's on some of their posts on their page. They said it in their responses from customer service. And this would be amazing if it were true, because white cast in sunscreens is a big problem. If you're in the US and you're sensitive to avobenzone, then you're kind of stuck with mineral sunscreens, and mineral sunscreens have a white cast. So if you have darker skin and you put on a standard mineral sunscreen, your face goes white and ghostly looking, and it's not very nice. Tinted sunscreens usually only come in like 3 colors, and if you're not one of those 3 colors, then you're going to look a little bit weird if you apply the right amount. So this way you can mix in one of these many shades of pigment and get your own custom tinted sunscreen. But the issue, of course, is whether or not it actually works, because mixing anything into a sunscreen could potentially disrupt its ability to form a continuous film. And it's that continuous film that will be protecting you. You don't want random gaps and cracks in your sun protection. There's a study from July 2020 in the Journal of Drugs and Dermatology from Dermablend that some people have sent me, and they said that this is the study that some people are citing for proof that the SPF isn't compromised. And I've looked at this. I actually looked at it for my blue light video, which I will link below, and it actually doesn't have anything to do with mixing, and it doesn't have anything to do with SPF. So no, this study does not show that we can do it this way. So I reached out to Dermablend. Actually, I reached out about 7 times since October. They said they'd send me the data a few times, and then eventually, after a lot of back and forth, mostly forth from me and a little bit of back from them, I ended up with this response in my DMs. We at Dermablend recommend following the current FDA guidelines for sunscreen application and directions for use on the sunscreen you are applying. We continually research to innovate and improve our products in order to share emerging learnings with dermatologists. So this is obviously a very carefully constructed and formal statement, and I'm not sure what happened between them promoting it to be used in this way and this statement. I'm guessing it's one of two things. They are studies that they believe show that mixing is fine, but they want to play it safe and not piss off the FDA, so they are tapping the sign. Or they've realized that they don't have enough evidence to recommend it after all, and so they're walking it back. Either way, it seems like the official stance from Dermablend is not to mix the pigment drops into your sunscreen, so don't mix the pigment drops into your sunscreen. But it seems like they haven't really put a lot of effort into telling people about this change in their policy. I think they've deleted some of their Instagram posts because since October, I remember commenting on some of their posts. Like, I just waited for them to post about the Dermablend drops so that I could drop in a relevant comment asking them politely for their data. And I can't actually find my comments anymore, so I think they must have deleted some of the posts. But it's still on the descriptions for Flawless Creator on the Ulta and Macy's websites. They have a tutorial in their Instagram story highlights showing you how to mix it into sunscreen. They have a quote from an interview with a dermatologist talking about how great it is to mix these drops into sunscreen. And they even have an Instagram tutorial with Hyram talking about showing you how to mix it into your sunscreen. I want to make it clear that I'm not blaming Hyram for anything, because like I said, a lot of the content from the brand has this tip. And so I'm pretty sure the brand told him he could do this. And why would you not trust a brand that's recommended by so many dermatologists? So I think Dermablend could probably just put a bit more effort into communicating this change in their advice, because what's in my DMs is very different from what you would get if you just look through the internet. So if I were producing a product like this, this is how I would test the claim. I would get a bunch of consumers to mix the pigment drops into the sunscreens themselves to see how much they mix and how they mix it, like how thoroughly. Then I would replicate the worst case scenarios in the lab with a bunch of different sunscreen formulations and then test them on people and see what the SPF is, see if the SPF drops. If the SPF stays around the same for all the common sunscreen formulations, then I would be happy with that claim. If it doesn't, because there are a lot of different sunscreen formulas, there are lots of different technologies used in different sunscreens, so yeah, I'd like to see that done on a range of sunscreens and have it stay good. So I don't know if that's possible. I'm guessing the drops would have to have some SPF protection in them for that to work. And yeah, there's just so many different formulations with sunscreens that I think it would be really difficult to make sure it didn't destabilize any of them. I'm not sure if it's possible, but maybe it is. That's it for today. Remember, these are just my opinions on the claims from these companies with the information I have. Maybe there's some information I don't have that would be relevant as well. Let me know if you agree or disagree in the comments. Also, let me know if you have other SPF products with weird claims that you want me to go through. I hope you liked this video. If you did, give it a thumbs up. You can subscribe to my channel as well. Check me out on Instagram and check out my blog, and I will see you next time.